if I'm doing this thing.
Thank you, Mark Dale. Thank you for your time.
No problem.
And I'll come and check out some of the off-spin rather than the leg spin. Thank you, sir. Speaking of a bit of off-spin, that won't please Mohamed Nabi because Big Rakeem couldn't get down in time. And it is raced away for four.
Chihul will be happy with this boundary. It might just kick the start. Here's innings for him. He's a high quality player. I feel he's just one innings away from being at his best. He'll play a lot of T20 matches in 2019, only four, so has the opportunity to play a full season now. Chihul goes straight. Nice shot to end the over. Consecutive boundaries, 10 runs from it. 47. One at the moment.
As long as it's below waist high, that's a giveaway. It flew a chase. The umpires are having a chat. Is it below waist height? Just for those new to the game, if it's above waist high when he hit it, when it arrived at the batsman standing upright at the crease, then it could be classified a no ball. Good way to introduce Tom Moody.
Good morning, Bish. No ball on the front line is absolutely fine, but now we just have to look at the height. That's the real question. What a swing of fortunes either way. I reckon that's got to be out. That's around about waist height. It's certainly not threatening. Frustration for Corey Anderson, because he would be thinking initially, what a gift my fellow countryman has just offered wide of off stump. He's got a full piece of it, but unfortunately for him, he's got a full piece of it and hit it straight to the fielder. So Ronson Chase takes a very good catch to get rid of Anderson. Anderson goes, a big wicket, goes for two. It's 47 for two.
Since departed, two wickets have fallen. The impressive Kyle Mayers has come to the crease. He played lovely innings in the first game, 37 in quick time. Kugelheim has come back very well after a couple of initial blows. Excellent line, good running. Thank you.
cover fielder. And always just a little bit worse when it's against someone from your own country, because he'll be reminding him that around the hotel over the next week or so, that I've got you in my pocket already. You just keep quiet. There'll be a bit of banter, no doubt, over that one. But a bit of luck for Anderson, not for Anderson, for Kugelheim. It's a poor delivery, should have been hit for four.
Tridents. It's good. Tridents were 51-3 in the previous game against the Patriots after the power play.
Sky Cam making its way up to give us some great pictures. Shea Hope is a particularly important player in their batting lineup, because there's a lot of power players in their top six, top seven, the Tridents, where he's a pure batsman, and I think he can play a really important role, not only today, but throughout this tournament for them, because he's a class act. He really is. He's technically sound, and he's got a very good record, and I think if he bats time and allows those power players to bat around him, I think that's going to be their most effective formula.
And I want to give you my interpretation of when you say bat time. I still want him to score at a strike rate generally of 130, I think, or slightly above that. I want him to be in that method of Virat Kohli. So when you're talking about batting time, I don't want people to feel that it's just, well, in my interpretation anyway, to just maybe go at a strike rate of 100. That's not good enough. Low risk, but still being able to time the ball, hit gaps. And that's how I see that. The other guys, Tom, around that, in my view, can then score at your 150s, your 170s, depending on the type and power of the player.
Many good examples of players like that around the world. You mentioned Virat Kohli, Kane Williamson from Australia is another, from New Zealand is another very good example of that. And it doesn't mean you need to be going at 130 from the get-go. It's at the completion of your innings, you're around that 130 mark. Fed it into the offside for a single. That's a good over. Only two coming from it. Seven overs gone now, it's 55 for two.
Dots in the innings, but they are a very boundary oriented batting lineup. The Trident, 6 fours, 2 sixes.
Involved with the Dream 11, just get on to dream11.com or download the app. Pick the players that you feel are going to have the biggest impact today, whether it's wickets, runs, catches, runouts. Get involved. First 10 or 20 balls they face. It's more about where they end up at the end of the innings and how that really applies to the rest of the team and the strength of the rest of the team, which is in this case with the Tridents, is they've got a lot of very good power hitters and it complements that. Players like this end up being put under too much pressure to play outside of their real strength and play extravagant shots early in their innings, and that can be their undoing.
You know, Well, Scorer's just given me some numbers there. He said overall Shea Hope's career strike rate is 124, but when he opens the batting, he goes at about 140 in 10 or 11 games. And it's important to make that distinction compared to his CPL career. He hasn't played a lot of matches, 19 before this, so it is perhaps his most useful position is right up there to play that role that you talked about. He can hit the ball over the top through the ring. Over. He never got the line right to Johnson Charles. He was too straight initially, even though he was short, and then he was too wide above stump. And 17.
Yeah, and his first over at Bish, which was the second over of the day, which really set the tone, I felt, for that power play, was his first two balls went for four. Nothing worse from a team perspective, but let alone an individual point of view, when you leak a couple of boundaries just through poor execution. Team meetings, that is always top of the conversation with regards to the bowlers, making sure you get into your over so you're into the contest without being on the back foot. If you're getting into the over and you're being hit for four because of a poor delivery, there's nothing worse. If you get hit for four or six and it's a decent delivery, well, so be it.
Finger spinner, he is comfortable bowling to both left and right handers, which is quite rare. Most spin bowlers that only spin the ball one way tend to have a preferred matchup to the left or right hand bat, where Nubby is very clever against the right hand bat, which a lot of traditional off spinners struggle against. Clearly he is ace when it comes to bowling to the left-hand batsman, because the ball is angling in and turning away.
This could be out in the air, and it's the long boundary, and it takes another victim. So Nubby strikes, the pressure builds up, and he picks up a key wicket.
And you've got to have your very good fielders, your exceptional fielders in the big acreage on that side of the ground. Shea Hope gave it everything. And everything on this occasion is not enough. Mark Dale takes a simple catch. So the wickets keep coming of late for Sammy and the Zouks. Shea Hope goes for 19, 64 for 3. Tridents captain Jason Holder strides to the crease. Got 38 in the first game from just 22 deliveries. I thought last season when the Tridents won the championship, he didn't quite show us his capabilities with the bat in that lineup. Others did the work for him batting-wise. Well done. Well done, Obed McCoy, to his strong side, his favourite hand, and he snatched it up.
It's about 75 metres out there on the long side against a gentle breeze. Always going to be difficult, Shea Hope, to reach that boundary. I'm sure he'll reflect now after that dismissal, thinking, why have I tried to hit that for six? I should have just hit it hard into the gap and searched for a four. Worst case scenario, a two.
Getting close to Keswick Williams' time with the ball. 65 for three, nine gone. Down towards Junior, who is quite capable and a developing all-rounder. Myers and Holder put on 61 in the first game, highest partnership of the tournament. Here's Keswick. Oh, would have been gone. Roston almost ran out. Jason.
Their long legs.
Which ones?
Everyone is talking. And he wasn't even in the picture there, Jason Holder. He needs a bit more time to wind those legs up to generate the speed, and he wasn't in the contest. Austin Chase had a perfect opportunity, but he only really had one stump to target, and he missed them.
It's a banter if that had struck the stumps as well, because Jason Holder and Roston Chase came through the system at a similar time. And I know Jason Holder has a great deal of respect and admiration for Chase's ability, but also his understanding of the game. Great friendship there. Jason's got him on high comfortably.
Jason Holder's got us all covered. He's about 6'8". He's one of the tallest players that's playing in this Hero CPL. It's good to see him batting up the order, because what we've seen him perform with the bat in other formats of the game,